So 120 years ago, Dr. Röntgen x-rayed his wife's hand. Quite why he had to pin her fingers to the floor with her brooch, I'm not sure. It seems a bit extreme to me. But that image was the start of the x-ray technology, and I'm still fundamentally using the same principles today, but I'm interpreting it in a more contemporary manner. The first shot I ever did was of a soda can, which was to promote a brand that we all know, so I'm not going to do them any favours by showing you it. But the second shot I did was my shoes that I was wearing on the day, and I do really like this shot because it shows all the detritus that's sort of embedded in the sole of the sneakers. It was just one of those potluck things where you get it right first time. Moving on to something a bit larger. This is an x-ray of a bus, and the bus is full of people. It's actually the same person, it's just one skeleton. Back in the 60s, they used to teach student radiographers to take x-rays, thankfully not on you and I, but on dead people. So I've still got access to one of these dead people called Frida. She's falling apart, I'm afraid, because she's very old and fragile. But everyone on that bus is Frida, and the bus is taken with a cargo scanning x-ray, which is the sort of machine you have on borders, which checks for contraband and drugs and bombs and things. Fairly obvious what that is. So using large-scale objects does sort of create drama because you just don't see x-rays of big things that often. Technology is moving ahead, and these large cargo scanner x-rays that work with a digital system are getting better and better and better. Again, though, to make it come alive, you need somehow to add the human element, and I think the reason this image works, again, is because Frida's driving the bulldozer. quite a difficult brief. Make a pair of men's pants look beautiful, but I think the process in itself shows how exquisite they are. Fashion. Now, I'm sort of anti-fashion because I don't show the surface, I show what's within. So the fashionistas don't really like me because it doesn't matter if Kate Moss is wearing it or if I'm wearing it, it looks the same. It's we all look the same inside, believe me. The creases in the material and the sort of nuances, and I show things for really what they are, what they're made of. I peel back the layers and expose it. And if it's well made, I show it. If it's badly made, I show it. And I'm sure Ross can associate that with design. The design comes from within. It's not just Top Show. I get some strange looks when I'm going out getting my props. Here I was fumbling around in the ladies' underwear department of a department store, almost got escorted from the premises. I live opposite a farm, and this was the runt of the litter, a piglet that died. And what's really interesting is that if you look at the legs, you notice that the bones haven't fused, and should that pig have grown, unfortunately it was dead. It would have certainly have been dead after I x-rayed it with the amount of radiation I used anyway. But once the bones are fused together, it would have been healthy. So that's an empty puffer jacket, but I quite like the way it's posed. Nature is my greatest inspiration. And to carry on with a theme that we've already touched with is how nature is related to architecture. If you look at the roof of the Eden Project or the British Library, it's all this honeycomb structure, and I'm sure those architects are inspired, as I am, by what surrounds us, by nature. This, in fact, is a Victoria water lily leaf that floats on the top of a pond, an amaryllis flower looking really three-dimensional, seaweed ebbing in the tide. Now, how do I do this and where do I do this and all that sort of thing? This is my new purpose-built x-ray shed, and the door to my x-ray room is made of lead and steel. It weighs 1,250 kilograms, and it's the only exercise I get is opening and closing it. The walls are 700 millimetres thick of solid, dense concrete, so I'm using quite a lot of radiation, a lot more than you'd get in a hospital or a vet's. And there I am. This is quite a high-powered x-ray machine. What's interesting, really, about X-ray, really, is if you think about it, is that that technology is used for sort of looking for cancer or looking for drugs or looking for contraband or whatever. And I use that sort of technology to create things that are quite beautiful. So still working with film, I'm afraid. Technology in X-ray, where it's life-size process, apart from these large cargo scanning machines, hasn't moved on enough for the quality of the image and the resolution to be good enough for what I want to do with it, which is show my pictures big. So I have to use a 1980s drum scanner. It was designed in the days when everyone shot photographs on film. They scan each individual x-ray, and this shows how I do my process of same-size x-ray. So this is, again, my daughter's dress. It still has the tag in it from me buying it, so I can take it back to the shop if you didn't like it. But there are four X-ray plates. You can see them overlapping. So when you move forward from something fairly small, a dress, which is this size, onto something like that, which is done in exactly the same process, you can see that that's a lot of work. In fact, that is 3 months solid X-raying. There's over 500 separate components. Boeing sent me a 747 in containers, and I sent them back an X-ray. I kid you not. Okay, so Frida is my dead skeleton. This, unfortunately, is basically two pictures. The one on the extreme right is a photograph of an American footballer. The one on the left is an X-ray. But this time, I had to use a real body because I needed all the skin tissue to make it look real, to make it look like he was a real athlete. So here I had to use a recently deceased body, and getting hold of that was extremely difficult, laborious. But people do donate their bodies to art and science, and when they do, I'm in the queue, so I like to use them. The colouring. So colouring adds another level to the X-rays. It makes it more organic, more natural. It's whatever takes my fancy, really. It's not accurately coloured to how it is in real life. That flower doesn't come in bright orange, I don't think, but I just like it in bright orange. And also with something technical, like these are DJ decks, it sort of adds another level. It makes a two-dimensional image look more three-dimensional. The most difficult things to X-ray, the most technically challenging things to X-ray, are the lightest things, the most delicate things. So to get the detail in a feather, believe me, if there's anyone out here who knows anything about X-rays, that's quite a challenge. I'm now going to show you a short film. I'll step to the side. The thing in there is very dangerous. If you touch that, you could possibly die through radiation poisoning. In my career, I've had two exposures to radiation, which is too many, because it stays with you for life. It's cumulative. It has human connotations, the fact it's a child's toy that we all recognise, but also it looks like it's a robot, and it comes from sci-fi genus. It's a surprise that it has humanity but also man-made future alien associations, and it's just a bit spooky. The bus was done with a cargo scanning X-ray machine, which is used on the borders between countries looking for contraband and illegal immigrants. The lorry goes in front of it and it takes slices of X-rays through the lorry. And that's how this was done. It's actually a slice. It's a bit like a CT scanner in a hospital. Slice. And then if you look carefully, there's all little things. He's got headphones on, reading the newspaper, got a hat on, glasses, got a bag. So these little details help to make it work, make it real. The problem with using living people is that to take an X-ray, if I X-ray you, you get exposed to radiation. So to avoid that, and I have to avoid it somehow, is I use dead people. Now, that's a variety of things, from recently deceased bodies to a skeleton that was used by student radiographers to train in taking X-rays of the human body at different densities. I have the very high-tech equipment of gloves, scissors and a bucket. I will show how the capillary action works, how it feeds. I'll be able to get all the cells inside that stem because it transfers food from its roots to its leaves. Look at this monster. It's so basic, it's just grows wild.
That's what I really like about it, the fact that I'm going to go and buy it and it hasn't been genetically modified at all, it's just happening. And show it, the x-ray shows how beautiful nature can be. Not that that is particularly beautiful when you look at it with a human eye. The way the leaves form, they're curling back on each other. So the x-ray will show the overlaps in these little corners. The thicker the object, the more radiation it needs and the more time it needs. The lighter the object, the less radiation. Sometimes you keep the time up because the time gives you detail a lot. The longer the exposure goes on for, the more detail you get. If you look at this particular, just the tube, it is quite bright. But I could get a bit darker in the tube, but everything else would suffer. So these leaves at the edge would start to disappear. What I like is how hard the edges are, how sharp.
Yeah, I'm quite pleased with that.
I travel beyond the surface and show something for what it's worth, what it's really made of, how it really works. But also I find that I've got the benefit of taking away all the surface, which is things that people are used to seeing.
And that's the sort of thing I've been doing. I've got the opportunity now to show you what I'm going to be doing in the future. This is a commercial application of my most recent work. And what's good about this, I think, is that it's sort of like a moment in time, like you've turned around, you've got x-ray vision, and you've taken the picture with the x-ray camera. Unfortunately, I haven't got x-ray vision. I do dream in x-ray. I see my projects in my sleep, and I know what they're going to look like in x-ray, and I'm not far off. So what am I doing in the future? Well, this year is the 50th anniversary of Sosigoni's Mini, which is one of my favourite cars. So I've taken it apart, component by component, months and months and months of work. And with this image, I'm going to be displaying it in the Victoria and Albert Museum as a light box, which is actually attached to the car. So I'm going to saw the car in half down the middle, not an easy task in itself. And then so you can get in the driver's side, sit down, and up against you is a wall. And if you get out and walk around the other side of the car, you see a life-size light box of the car showing you how it works. And I'm going to take that idea and apply it to other sort of iconic things from my life. Like my first computer was a big movement in my life. I had a Mac Classic, and it's a little box, and I think that would look quite neat as an x-ray. I'm also looking to take my work from the two-dimensional form to a more three-dimensional form. And this is quite a good way of doing it. I'm also working now with x-ray video, so if you can imagine some of these flowers and they're actually moving and growing and you can film that in x-ray, should be quite stunning. But that's it, I'm done. Thank you very much.
Traffic is a global epidemic. US traffic is creating 45% of the world's air pollution. In the UK, time wasted in traffic costs $20 billion a year. Would you pay for cleaner air and a faster commute? Stockholm put it to a vote.
I voted for it, yes.
I voted for it.
I vote for it.
We're not old enough to vote.
We had to do something in Stockholm to improve the environment and to get a better flow in the traffic. We put a price on taking your car into the central parts of Stockholm, and we call that congestion charges.
If you start a system like this and it doesn't work on the first day, then you will be in big trouble. It must be perfect from day one.
There are 18 entry gates to the city. Each is equipped with cameras.
Pictures are taken of the rear and front license plates. These pictures are sent to a central system that identifies the license plates and makes sure that the right person pays for the right passages.
One of the obstacles we overcame was the OCR, the optical character reading of the license plate. We went out to IBM's global organization and the R&D centers and found a very good software we could use. And we managed to implement it in 2 months' time.
This is the heart of the system where all images and passages are being processed. Over 99% of all pictures are correctly identified.
No, it's nice. This is how it should be all the time.
Behind me you can see the traffic, and the clock is 6 p.m.
Before we had the congestion charging, the traffic was chewing up at this time of the day.
Jag tycker det är en bra idé.
I think it's a good idea because I think that we should take care of the environment in the city.
The traffic went down with about 22% and the air pollution was about 14% better.
It's a huge international interest from different parts of the world, from the United States, from Latin America, from China, and it's really pressure to tell people not what we are planning to do, but what we actually have done in Stockholm.
I voted for it, yes, I did. Not my husband, so, but I did. I think he is not thinking like me for the future. I'm thinking for the children and the grandchildren.